Welcome to this fifth podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to positive, tolerable, and toxic stress. We will talk about the three types of stress we can encounter in our daily lives, how the allostatic response of the body to situations of toxic stress creates the allostatic load, and identify the source and long-term effects of toxic stress on our bodies and lives. To begin, it's important to remember that our early experiences are built into our brain architecture, so it's critical that we create positive experiences and environments in which our children can develop the skills to effectively deal with stress. For the purpose of this podcast, we are defining three types of stress. Positive stress is stress which is moderate and short-lived, causing brief increases in heart rate or mild changes in stress hormone levels. Positive stress is regarded as an important and necessary aspect of healthy development that occurs in the context of stable and supportive relationships and could involve meeting new people or dealing with frustration. Tolerable stress is stress which is severe enough to disrupt brain architecture if unchecked, but is buffered by supportive relationships that facilitate adaptive coping and mitigate the damaging effects. Tolerable stress generally occurs within a time-limited period, which gives the brain an opportunity to recover from potentially damaging effects. Examples of tolerable stress include a natural disaster or an illness or death of a family member. Toxic stress is stress that is severe, chronic, and uncontrollable, and occurs in the absence of the buffering protection of supportive relationships. Toxic stress results in prolonged and elevated levels of circulating stress hormones that can damage biological tissues, disrupt brain architecture, and ultimately lead to lifelong problems in learning, behavior, and increased risk of both physical and mental illness. Examples include physical abuse, neglect, or family violence. When stress hormones remain elevated over long periods of time, they produce wear and tear on the brain and certain biological systems. This effect is called allostatic load, and it's associated with vulnerability to health problems later in life. Dr. Megan Gunner is a professor of child development at the University of Minnesota. Here she describes allostatic load and its prolonged effects on the brain.
Allostatic load does influence the brain. One of the regions that's been looked at the most is an area called the hippocampus, but we also see it in the frontal cortex and in other regions of the brain. Excess stress hormone release, let's talk cortisol here, produces excitatory neurochemicals that activate neurons. But if this is prolonged, it can actually kill the neuron. It can damage the neuron. So one of the ways that the neuron protects itself is by pulling back all its little points of connections with other neurons. And if you look at the brain, it looks like that region is getting smaller, right? And this has been observed in both the prefrontal cortex and in the hippocampus. Once the stress is over, often these things come back, right? One of the effects is under chronic stress, for example, if you've got an older parent that you've had to maybe put in a nursing home because they had a fall or something, they might get very confused for a while, have trouble remembering things. You'll have to tell them over and over, and you think, oh my gosh, this is it. This is the end, right? And then after they get more comfortable and calm down, their function seems to come back a bit. Well, it's probably, we don't know for sure, but it's probably something like protecting the brain from the stress by retracting and then being able to come back. In development, however, if the brain is developing while this is occurring and other parts of the brain are trying to build themselves on this faulty input, we tend to see a much more prolonged impact of chronic stress in terms of brain volume.
The allostatic response of the body to situations of toxic stress, therefore, creates the allostatic load. acute and chronic stress can have lasting effects on the body. Dr. Matthew Hill from the University of Calgary describes the allostatic response of the body in addition to the diseases of allostatic load.
And basically, the allostatic response is what allows us to respond to a threat but then come back to normal. Now, the cost that the body takes from doing this repeatedly is what we refer to as an allostatic load. And this is essentially a way of saying wear and tear. And so every time we kind of go through this process, you know, your blood pressure jacks up, your heart rate increases, you affect all these brain processes, you affect inflammation and immune function. There's a lot of things that get turned on. Now, in the immediate term, that's good, but it's kind of like, you know, if you turn a light switch on and off and on and off and on and off, sooner or later the light's going to blow. Like, systems just aren't developed to be used that much. And so now stressors, especially those of the toxic nature, which have been talked about, are very effective at kind of inducing an allostatic load response. And so, as I said, the allostatic load basically discusses the breakdown of these systems. And so you can't keep turning something on and off and having it move around like that without there essentially being a cost taken on the body. And so in the health sense, what we think of an allostatic load with stress is most likely things that fall under the umbrella of cardiovascular, inflammatory, as well as mental and metabolic diseases, which actually is a pretty big umbrella that essentially covers the whole body.
So what are the internal mechanisms that contribute to allostatic load? Well, studies have proven that children who are exposed to toxic stress develop what is called glucocorticoid resistance, or impairment in the actions of glucocorticoids. This leads to an increase in the corticotropin-releasing hormone receptors in the brain and the development of a variety of inflammatory conditions in both white blood cells and the central nervous system. Dr. Hill explains.
So basically, and now I'm really getting redundant because I've really tried to hammer this home, so I apologize, but this creates kind of a very nice model of how early life stress would then translate into this state of allostatic load that would set the stage for these diseases in adulthood. So you have adverse experiences in early life, most commonly from the data that's been presented, child abuse or maltreatment, emotional neglect, seems to be the most critical in this, which causes an experience-dependent increase in the chemical markers on the glucocorticoid receptor gene, which essentially silences its production. Not completely, but enough that there's less levels of receptors. This reduction in the glucocorticoid receptors results in development of resistance, which then heightens the sensitivity to stress, impairs glucocorticoid feedback, sensitizes CRH signaling pathways, and increases inflammation. This shift in the functioning of the stress axis essentially creates a state of susceptibility to both mental illness, especially depression, as well as other health conditions that have been talked about, obesity, cardiovascular health. So the allostatic load, which is incurred by this increased sensitivity to stress, in turn also seems to set the stage to have these effects on brain structures, as we talked about in adults. So you have the shrunken neurons within the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus. And again, since these structures are very important for the processing and the termination of stress, the fact that they've been compromised in turn also seems to then kind of feed into this cycle and make everything more vulnerable. The other thing that comes out of the prefrontal cortical volume changes is the idea that if this structure isn't working properly, this may account at least in part for the reason why you see the emergence of increased levels of risk-taking behaviors, impulsivity, things like smoking, alcoholism, promiscuity, which have all been documented in individuals who underwent early life stress. And so the fact that the prefrontal cortex might not be working as well seems to be a major player in this.
Now that we understand the types of stress and the neurological effects of chronic toxic stress, what are some of the sources and effects of toxic stress? Dr. Gunner lists sources of toxic stress and the associated developmental impairments in young children.
We know a lot of sources that can produce toxic stress in young children. Neglect, abuse, exposure to violence, parental mental illness, parent substance abuse, you all can add to this list, I'm sure. Situations where it is reasonable to expect that the child's biology will frequently need to kick into high gear to protect the child, to allow the child to manage that. We know that if we count these up, we've spent a long time in science trying to figure out what is the exact relationship between each of these types of negative things and outcomes. It's very challenging. There's not a lot of unique relationships. What we tend to find over and over is what's called cumulative risk. The more you add these things up, the more negative the outcomes. As if, I tend to think of that as knocking out legs under the stool of the chair, right? You can knock them out and then finally it just finally goes.
The Adverse Childhood Experiences, or ACE study, has also studied stressful situations such as abuse and family dysfunction and linked these experiences to the development of depression later in life. Dr. Hill elaborates.
But the ACE studies followed individuals who underwent various forms of early life stress through retrospective analysis. The two forms of adversity were broadly categorized into two areas. So you had abuse, which fell under the umbrella of physical, sexual, and emotional, as well as familial dysfunction. And this went along with something along the lines of a household substance abuse, like one of the parents was a drug addict, one of the parents was in jail, they had a parent who was depressed, underwent a divorce. So those were kind of the broad ways in which early life stress was separated. So exposure to one of the key things with depression is that there is a clear dose-responsive curve that has emerged with respect to exposure to adverse childhood events, the number of them, and the prevalence of developing depression in life. The more ACEs that someone was exposed to earlier in life, the greater incidence they had of depression as adults. So some interesting points came out of these studies, though. The first one being that the relationship between early life adversity and depression was stronger in women than in men. Emotional abuse as a child was the most likely predictor of depression in adulthood. And both women and men were approximately 3 times as likely to develop depression if they were exposed to emotional abuse in childhood. And then also forms of familial dysfunction and isolation were not significantly associated with depression. So it does seem that the depression stuff is very linked to this kind of early life abuse and emotional neglect and maltreatment. So just to quickly mention just some of the other things that have come out of these studies, other health risks that are obviously of importance, because this isn't a petri dish, all these things kind of go together. We have a 2-fold increase in obesity, a 7-fold increase in alcoholism, a 1.7-fold increase in smoking, 3.5-fold increase in promiscuity, and a 5.5-fold increase in intimate partner violence. So there's a lot of these kind of negative behaviors that are clustering together and are coming out following these kind of early life adversities.
In closing, research in this presentation highlights the significance of providing children with nurturing, protective relationships and appropriate learning experiences early in their lives in order to minimize the exposure to and effects of toxic stress. Though our brains retain the capacity to change and adapt even as we age, once it develops, the exaggerated neurological response to toxic stress never goes away, with costly consequences for both children and society. According to the research presented, better life outcomes could be achieved by decreasing the number and severity of adverse early experiences and by strengthening the relationships that protect young children from the harmful effects of toxic stress. So here is a summary of the key points in this podcast. There are 3 types of stress that we encounter in our lives: positive, tolerable, and toxic stress. Positive and tolerable stress build resilience, whereas toxic stress negatively impacts brain structure development. Common sources of toxic stress include abuse and neglect, and these can lead to developmental delays in social, cognitive, and emotional skills in children. Stressful situations such as abuse and family dysfunction can lead to the development of depression and other illnesses or health risks, such as anxiety and addiction later in life. Nurturing protective relationships and appropriate learning experiences early in life can help to minimize the exposure to and effects of toxic stress. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMeds competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how would you integrate and apply what you've learned about positive, tolerable, and toxic stress? Does what you have learned inform how you might manage your own stress? 2. Do you think an interface exists between stress and the other determinants of health? 3. When and how do you think it would be appropriate to address early childhood issues with someone struggling with addiction? What professional skills would be required to do so? How could you maintain patient safety? 4. How would you address the problem of a parent or family subjecting a child to toxic stress? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on positive, tolerable, and toxic stress. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.